So I've managed to escape the office today and I brought you down to the river here. This is the River Cam in Cambridge. And I brought you down to the river because I want to talk about pi. So what does pi have to do with rivers? Let me show you. So let me draw an approximation of the River Cam here, or any river, in fact. Here is my picture, there you go, of a river. What does this have to do with pi? Well, we can measure how bendy this river is, how much it meanders, by taking the length of the river. That's the whole length, which we might call capital L, and we divide that by the direct route. There we go, as the crow flies. That direct route, well, it's going to be much quicker. We're going to call that little L. So we're going to divide by little L. That figure is called sinuosity. So we'll call that S for sinuosity. It's a measure of how bendy the river is. So if the river was completely straight, then it would have a sinuosity of 1. Or if it was really bendy, it would have a high sinuosity. There's no limit to how high sinuosity can be. But there are some people who figured out that, well, in theory, the average sinuosity of rivers should be pi. So if we took the River Cam here and we looked at its total length, which could be, I don't know, 10 miles, divided that by the direct route, then we should get something like 3.14. Now, it might be bigger than that, it might be smaller than that, but if we look at all the rivers in the world, the average should be about 3.14. So the length of a river is just over 3 times longer than the direct route. How did these guys justify this? Well, this was published in a paper in Science in the 90s. They were actually trying to model rivers and how they meander and bend. They used fluid dynamics to model the flow of a river. And sometimes they became very bendy and the behavior became very chaotic. And then suddenly all the rivers became straight again because they would form something that is known as oxbow lakes. So if I have a river here, if it becomes very, very bendy like this, then what can happen is the water will find a shortcut. It will go across this, it will cut off this large bend, and this forms an oxbow lake. So this will dry out and it is no longer part of the river. The river becomes more straight by forming this oxbow lake. So it becomes straighter. So they found that the highest sinuosity tended to be around 3.5, so it didn't just go unlimitedly large. So high sinuosities were about 3.5, low sinuosities were about 2.7, so not all the way down to 1, and it would tend to sort of meander between those two values. So it's the formation of these oxbow lakes that control the sinuosity of a river. Now, how is this meandering caused? Well, as the water flows through the river, on the outside of the bend, it starts to erode here, so it becomes more bendy. On the inside of the curve, it starts to deposit soil, and this is how you form the bends, but these oxbow lakes then cut off the bend. They did try and justify, they tried to justify that figure pi in the footnotes. It was footnote 14 of the paper. And to justify it, they went to fractal geometry. And they said, well, the curves of a river are like arcs of a circle. And the little wiggles of a river, they're like little arcs of circles. And if you add up all these arcs together, then the sinuosity you get should be around about pi. I did wonder for a long time if this was internet folklore. I did have to look at the paper to see if it was justified. They are using a model here. So it was a fluid dynamics model. They invoked this fractal geometry to justify this pi figure. The rivers they're modeling was unrestricted by geography. In real life, would you get this figure? Well, the theory says we should. But in real life, do we? That's an interesting question.
world's really well mapped now. Has no one checked this? Has no one fed in the Amazon and the Nile and said, well, what's the reality?
I've tried to find the data. I've looked for the data. I've tried to find it. I couldn't find a nice set of data. I think I found a paper about rivers in Norway, but I couldn't get access to it. So I did try for you. I did try and find out. So if anyone wants to have a look at the sinuosity of their local river and see if it's anywhere near Pi, that would be interesting. It may not be near Pi because this is an average we're talking about. It could be hugely meandering. It could have a huge sinuosity. It could be very straight. We need to get all the rivers in the world and have a look at their data. Plus, we do have restrictions in real life.
Other than using Pi, so the entire thing's going to be Pi based. We get the circumference in an exact number of Pis, give or take.
Can you do that again and this time talk me through it as you do it?
You ask a lot, Brady. I'll try. So 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 9, bend up to 9, back to 2, and then we've got